Welcome to our second edition of The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. We're going to continue our chronological, historical Vince Ornato path to being a Pittsburgh professional artist right now. The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Vince is a professional Pittsburgh artist that works in many mediums. And now Vince is going to share his creative process with you. Vince Ornato, we're inside in your studio here. It's just fantastic. We're going to do the show continuing where we left off. Yeah, are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. That first show was just great. Hope everybody enjoyed it. You're going to see an even better one with The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Now, we left off at the National Record Mart and the VIP, and I'm beyond what you were saying those dancers were, so we'll just continue. And I would just like to bring this up to just continue what we have, Vince.
Yeah, this was some of the type of graphic design type of work I was doing at National Record Mart. Some people may not know because they're too young, but National Record Mart was a retailer in the tri-state area that had approximately anywhere from 75 to 85 retail record outlets all through Western PA, a little bit into West Virginia, as I recall, and some Ohio. Also owned Oasis Records. Some of you folks remember that.
Yes, I do.
But I was doing this type of graphic design work while beginning to get hired to do caricatures at parties and different things. And the VIP nightclubs had me at their clubs for a couple years during this period. This was some of the type of stuff I was doing.
Let me set this down.
Again, these were in-store concepts for ads. I was also doing signs by hand. This was a winter campaign, winter chills, music thrills, that type of stuff. It was sort of like the keep it simple and stupid method really does.
The kiss method,
the
one
kiss
of my favorites.
Method. Yeah, you have to think simply, not so much stupid, but simply, really, to get this across.
Vince,
quickly.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
I see all this graphic design artwork. How long would it take to get this done?
You know, it's a tricky question because sometimes the concepts sort of fly at you, but even at that, you got to work them up. So it's sort of like when people ask me for caricatures, for example, they say, how long does it take? I say 3 minutes in one lifetime.
And we'll get to that.
Yeah, so this is really, you know, it's a result of staying with it and working. So the process, and these days, this is pre-digital, I'm working out some thumbnail ideas. You know, the boss gives you something, whether it's winter, Valentine's Day.
So you got to go with what his directive was and make it your own.
He gives
for something
me
like this.
The starting point, yeah. And then I just have to develop. This idea was to have musical notes coming out of the chimney on a winter's day. And so winter chills, music thrills. This other one here, this was an extension.
Let me set this down or hand it back to you.
This was an extension of the heartthrobs Valentine's Day. I actually came up with the idea of putting a sticker on the albums that are on sale. They used to have posters of these long lists of which records were on sale. Well, as you remember, you walk in the store and there were thousands of records.
It was overwhelming.
It was overwhelming. And then you'd see this long list. So I said, why not just have a sign that says, anyone with a sticker, these are the ones on sale. And it worked like gangbusters. And it was a really neat campaign. And I always tell people, working there in that advertising department was like working at WKRP in Cincinnati.
Really? What an analogy.
And even the people working there, when I'd say that, oh, yeah, because it was, you know, there were crazy salespeople, there were all kind of characters, office girls, and it was just, it was a neat kind of incubator for me to work out ideas.
How many people were in that office?
The advertising department probably had a dozen all told, and then there was the sales force. This was over on Baum Boulevard in Shadyside. A lot of people didn't even know it was there because they did not have a logo on its building. That's where all the records were stored and the merchandise and everything. There was really no need for a logo. It wasn't the retail outlet. It was over near Negley and Baum. So, but it was good working there, and I was making some money, and then I was starting to get involved with doing caricatures at different events and so on. And what happened was I wanted to get more towards illustration because I wanted to get into more advanced drawing and painting. I just wanted to get better. You know, it was just something I wanted to get better at.
So you're continuing to try to improve and expand what you could do to make money.
That's right. Okay. The whole time I'm supporting myself this way. Again, it was sort of a meager living, but I was in the hunt and on the road. Right. And what started happening was as I applied myself, I began to carry my sketchbook everywhere.
Here we go, folks. And this is what I want you to see.
Yeah, this was This was actually New Orleans. I had my sketchbook down when I was in New Orleans. This is Preservation Hall, a very renowned jazz club down there. These are photocopies of the drawings. This was a man waiting for a bus in Pittsburgh. Bus stop guy. I did it in my sketchbook, but I was doing this type of stuff.
I'm amazed from what you first said you didn't even know about the black lines. And that's
right.
Why I was kidding you.
Right.
Now I'm looking at many different variances of that black line.
Well, I've told people, like, you know, when I enrolled in night school, I hadn't drawn in 3 years.
Right.
Now for 30 years, I've drawn almost every day.
Right.
So that's the big change. And so you saw those couple sketches. The next thing I started
give me
doing,
more. I'm excited about what you're handing next to me. This is awesome.
This is the Pennsylvanian downtown when they were restoring it, and it took me 3 days. I did this on site. You saw those sketches I just showed.
Yes.
They're smaller, more rapid. The same principle is involved.
And what do you mean by rapid? The time?
Time. Yeah. Okay. They're more of I'm calling it a rapid drawing. Like the bus stop guy took about 7 minutes, but as I say, 7 minutes in one lifetime. So right. I'm expanding my mind, and I started doing
larger pieces,
and lo and behold, I don't have it with me, but one of the...
You mean in this studio? Come on,
well,
man.
Well, I sold it. What happened?
Well, congratulations to you. That's great.
Yeah, some of the these sketches out in diners or whatever I draw, and they'd come over and want to buy them off me. And I thought, boy, this is interesting. I was really in my mind practicing.
Sure.
My girlfriend at the time, I remember she was a CMU graduate. She was an artist. And, you know, she was linking up for me because she had more of a formal education that what I was doing was art. And they were drawings. I was never even in an art gallery till I was about 28 years old. And this was...
You got to be kidding me.
Yeah. Again, people think I sort of just went one step in front of the other and it just all fell into place, but...
It's a process.
It's a process, and it's very convoluted and a twisting road, and then it starts straightening out. But I'm drawing every day now.
Okay.
That's what's going on. So I started doing some more advanced work like this, and I started selling these, and again, in my mind, it's an attempt to
move that chair out of the way so you can get to your
attempt to practice and improve. And in my mind, I'm still thinking,
let's see this one. Whoa, look at this frame!
But this is I sell lithographs as some of the drawings.
Explain what a lithograph is.
Well, a lithograph is a high quality reproduction process.
Okay.
Of you know,
is it a numbered amount of them, or
you could? Well, these are numbered. Yeah, you could do.
I know a couple things. I just figured I'd put that out.
A limited edition, or what they call an open edition, which is not numbered.
Is this a limited edition?
Yeah, this is limited.
How many?
250.
And, okay. And this is the last one. I understand.
I'm probably up to having sold 75 or so.
I'm an optimist.
But anyway, this was an ink drawing down the strip district. I did my sketchbook. And then I hand tinted this lithograph with watercolor, and you could see the development, the progression of those more rapid.
Well, thanks
sketches
for bringing this work out, because this is part of what I wanted to show people.
Right.
That now in a couple of years, look what you're doing.
Yeah, and we're going to get into that. One last point on this: when you saw the graphic design type stuff from National Record Mart, there is a compositional relationship between that and this. People don't see it until I
Explain it, please.
Well, yeah, artists know about it, photographers know about it, filmmakers know about it, but you're always thinking in terms of graphic design, design meaning concept and composition. So whereas like the National Record Mart retail store stuff, I have to make it fit and work and understand what's the first point, what's the second point, where do I
and
want to
And they're dictating what you have to put into it.
Not necessarily. Okay. They want my feedback.
Okay.
You know, because
but I mean the general part of it.
They give me the initial concept, the germ, and then I have to go from there.
Okay.
Because the result you saw, I might have done 7 or 8 quick thumbnails to pick 2 or 3 to develop further.
To narrow it down. You're narrowing down
the
process.
Yeah, we're going to go with this one. So,
sure.
And then once you get that, the compositional things, all that stuff applies, whether it's painting, ads. These days, there's too many people.
You want me to hold this?
No, I'm okay.
Okay.
Thanks. Too many people are just jumping on a computer and thinking if you make something fit, then it's right. Well, they're not really developing the composition properly. They're kind of working on the finish before they really develop. That's why you see so much cluttered design work these days. And websites are just filled with that stuff.
Right to what I talk about all the time, that I can't believe it. Keep it simple. And even though this is more complex, there's actually a simplicity to it.
That's what
right?
you want. Yeah, simplicity is strength. And
you have something else you want to bring up?
Yeah,
right now?
One quick one before we get to the paintings here.
Okay. Little teaser, folks.
This
in
is
TV land.
Again, this was another on-site Stutz's Pharmacy. A lot of people remember it.
I recall, yes.
Absolutely. And way in a deep background here up in Arlington, you're seeing the baseball field, and I did this on site. Again, the other
How long did this take?
This was a 2-day, probably 3 hours each day.
Okay.
Let me point something out, too, that I'm drawing on site. I'm not copying photographs, and that's a very important breakthrough.
Sure.
Because you're now interpreting three-dimensional form and putting it on a two-dimensional surface.
Gotcha.
Giving the illusion of three-dimensional. This really isn't Stutz's Pharmacy. What it is a bunch of ink on a piece of a tree. Okay, that's what's really going on.
Okay.
It's made. I made this.
You created it.
I created it, and this is the language, a part of the historical visual language.
And this is part of your development moving beyond the chalk sketch caricatures.
Yeah, it's not so far removed from the cave drawings found in France that are 3,500 years old, because whoever did those is looking at something and rendering it. And they've also figured out that, like the animal, the bison or whatever the heck the cave person was looking at, they're seeing they use the contour of the cave and different things. And I just saw something about, there's what they call audio historians, I just found out.
Sure.
This guy figured out that the best acoustics in these particular caves had more drawings than any other location. So they wonder, were they actually doing performances with this? But it's not far removed at all from what I am doing here. Modern equipment, modern media, but it's the same sort of principle.
It's the basic. Yeah.
Yeah, it's the basic. And you can say that about music with rhythms and sounds and so on and so on.
Sure.
So that got me drawing, and I'm starting to sell this stuff.
Well, I see you're putting color in there.
Yeah, and I'm not really painting yet. I'm getting to a point.
That's what I'm leading to, but that's what I was going to ask.
Well, I'll tell you an interesting story. This really did happen. In my mind, I thought I would draw, while I'm making a living the way I told you,
sure.
In my mind, I thought I would draw for 2 years, and then I got to figure out
how to paint.
I'm not
like
going to worry about painting. In my mind, this is what I figured out, because I had to make a living and support myself while I'm doing all this. And after the 2 year point, generally 2 years, I will figure out how to paint and how to follow that. So, a good friend of mine, who I got to know, I started doing these shows, arts and craft shows, out of town. I was doing caricatures at them. And it was a way to make a decent amount of money in a short time. And then that gave me time to practice back here. And I bought this studio house. And again, it's a meager
living.
What
time frame was this?
This was like 1990-ish by now.
Okay.
And I'm into this for about 6 years or so.
Okay.
You know, as I said, 7 years. I started.
So you come out of the 80s. Now it's 90.
Yeah. And I'd gone to college for writing. And, you know, I was a writing major in college and rhetoric major. I got into art afterwards, which I didn't start out right off the bat. I was in my mid-20s when I really got into
show
this.
Number one? we go into that.
Yeah, yeah. And the first show, which is online, and we're going to...
On TV.
We're going to deal with all that.
Sure.
But 5 years into this or so, I knew I had tapped into something. I'd now gone to art at galleries. I was no longer thinking exclusively in terms of commercial art, but this was becoming a means of expression for myself.
Okay.
Because I was starting to see things in nature, in cities, and I love cities. I'm from Pittsburgh, born and raised, born at Mercy Hospital.
Sure,
right?
And, sure.
And I'm starting to see this now as a personal form of expression to have my own point of view. And I'm selling some of these drawings, and I started getting involved a little bit in lithographs. I didn't make much money, made some,
sure,
but I'm finding out about the general field.
You're learning, you're getting the word out about you, and people actually want to purchase these.
Yeah, and it's funny, artwork. I'm getting an education from a business standpoint also that I didn't necessarily think about. I mean, I was drawing and painting for a full-time living for 10 years before I'm calling myself an artist because I felt I had earned that, but other people were saying
acknowledging that already.
Yeah, and then the business side of it was just another long accumulation. So at some point, I'm doing these mall shows out of town from time to time, up in New York State area, Connecticut, different places.
What are you doing at the mall shows?
I'm doing caricatures.
Okay, that's what I wanted to get out here so I understand that.
Yeah, on my website, actually, you can see a film clip of me in one of the malls in Danbury, Connecticut, idrawfaces.com. Also, there's a clip of me on ESPN.
Well, this is what caricatures. I want to talk about because I'm a sports guy.
Yeah.
You're on ESPN. How did that even come about? Because you're talking about being an artist here, drawing chalk caricatures in Kennywood.
Right.
Now you're on ESPN. You know those four initials are pretty big.
Yeah, they're pretty well known.
Tell me that story because this is fantastic. Wait till you hear this.
I visited a friend on Martha's Vineyard. I come back there. I saw on a show list there was a show in Danbury, Connecticut.
Okay.
And this mall show. I do the mall show. I made twice as much money as I ever had in a show. Okay. It was kind of a...
Fantastic.
I thought it was like an add-on thing just to make some money while I was on the road. I start doing that show. One time, I'm busy. I'm done. The promoter comes over and they said, someone from ESPN was watching you. Here's their phone number. They want to know if you can come on air Friday night.
A live show.
I said, what? And they had just started ESPN2, and Keith Olbermann was the host and all this. And next thing I knew, Friday night, they hired me to come on and just do the anchors in the beginning, but it was going so well. I was there for 3 hours, and Susie Colbert and Mitch Albom people. And I cannot tell you, they couldn't have been more professional, Stuart Scott.
Sure.
And they were all, Stuart Scott was extremely nice. They all were. And I had a ball, and they had a ball with me. And the film clip, highlights of it, is on my website.
I've seen that.
But, yeah. And it was funny, the credibility that gave me when people would call me here about hiring me for a party or something, which I still do. I still do plenty of them. But along those, I started to meet other artists, okay,
right,
working artists in different parts of the country. And a very good portrait artist friend of mine, Betsy White, who lives up in Massachusetts now, her and I were in the Metropolitan Museum in New York.
Nice.
Checking it out. And remember, this is a period I'm not painting. I'm only drawing.
Right.
This is like
and
a
we're
going
to get to
thing.
Painting right. shortly.
Right, right.
We have some nice paintings here.
And I turned to Betsy after about 2 hours in the museum. I said, I got to get out of here. And she said, what's going on? And I said, the paintings are talking to me. She looked at me. She said, are you okay? I said, I don't know. It's really weird. She said, what are they saying?
Yeah.
And you have to know Betsy. She just talked about it like it was the weather. And yeah. I said, they're asking me how come I'm not painting yet. And she looked at, and we had a, I literally had to go outside because my head was getting so filled up with understanding what I was looking
it
at.
It just clicked
now.
For you now.
And I was due. I was sort of like emotional constipation. So I...
Folks, we're learning all kind of combinations.
All kind of new phrases.
Right.
And, but I was seeing it so clearly in my head now, but I wasn't doing it to that next level.
Sure.
And
and then what happened?
I started taking some painting workshops here in Pittsburgh.
Okay.
And I wasn't...
Where at?
I would see Pittsburgh Center for the Arts, anywhere they would have these one-day, two-day workshops, things like that. But I wasn't getting the depth and the level that I felt I needed.
Right.
Eventually found some really, really good painters in town here. But another show up there, Betsy, again, she takes me to this lecture on Sunday night by Daniel Green.
And if you want to... You mentioned him in the first show. Tell us right now, because I want to see paintings.
Yeah, he's a master. Dan is he's an incredible person. He's well into his 70s now, and you can look at his work on his website. Green with an E, Daniel
Green. I have
Green.
Because
yeah.
of you.
It's incredible.
Yes.
Right? It's incomprehensible. And if the output, the advanced work that he does at his age and the output is just amazing. Anyway, that got me painting, and I became sort of a classroom assistant for a few weeks each summer
really?
For him. Yeah.
Now you're teaching.
Well, I was listening a lot.
Okay. Thanks.
But again, the serious people found each other, and I have this wonderful kind of family tree of artists that I got to know that way. So anyhow, you can grab Glory Days right there.
Right here?
Yeah.
Okay, this is one of my favorites, too.
Yeah, this kind of, how's this for the shot? Looking pretty good, Derek.
Oh, right. Look, it's fantastic.
Yeah, this
that color is amazing.
Oh, that looks great, yeah. Wow, did I do that? This is a
Vince the artist.
This is a reproduction, by the way, on canvas. I have a very good printer, Alex Patho, that I work with. Patho, Alex Patho. The original, I sold the original years ago, and we do these reproductions on canvas. It's a Giclée print. It's a high-quality archival print.
It's amazing.
But I had a very small industrial commission, and I wasn't doing industrial work yet. And this is this is 10, 12 years after ironworking.
Right.
But when I did that one commission, Al, it was like all the sounds, the smells. I was in a lot of mills. And,
sure.
And what I'm really proud of is that when people see my work, they go, "Wow, you really get the feeling." And you're from Pittsburgh.
It. Yeah.
Yeah.
Been in mills. I didn't work in them, but
And I love our history. I'm upset with people who want to hide it and put it down because, you know, their myopic view is pollution. It's weird. You know, Pittsburgh built the world, and they're so afraid that people will think there's smoke here. They're sort of paranoid. It's just a strange thing because the history is one of the most important in the entire world.
Sure.
And anyway,
anything you want to tell us about this painting at all?
Well, it's the famous view. It's called Glory Days, and it's the famous view coming in Boulevard of the Allies, Parkway East, looking down into the city. This is the high-level bridge. It's the J&L mill that ran along 2nd Avenue.
Yes.
The technology center's there now,
exactly.
As you know. And when I painted, this was a big epiphany for me. This was one that I realized that this industrial stuff is in my heart. I understand it. And I wanted to do the next one. And then the next one and the next one. And in many ways, that's sort of what I've become.
Do we have a next one in the show?
Yeah, you can set that aside.
All right.
And then let's grab Clearton here.
All right. You guide me.
This is, this is the Clearton Works. Again, this is a reproduction on canvas.
Look at that.
I sold the original. One of my clients is, I'm doing a lot of paintings for him based on the history of manufacturing in America. And this was actually completed when he saw it, and he loved it so much that he bought it, and so on and so on. But this, again, this is the famous Clearton Mill. It's the largest coal plant in the world. Many people mistakenly think this smoke is pollution. It's actually steam. It's just steam. But most of the pollution is rerouted back into the mills these days. It's amazing. The advancements in pollution
the technology,
handling,
yeah.
It's incredible. And that never gets any, you're not going to hear about that on television. They can't sell advertising telling you good news, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So, but it's very interesting. The pollution comes out and gets rerouted back into the mill, and they turn it into energy. I don't fully understand all that. But this is another piece here. It's just occurring to me, right behind you, I could actually take down, if you give me half a second.
You got half a second.
Let me take down Quitting Time. And this was inspired by a book I just loaned you, and Al really does read books.
Yes.
I had loaned it to him, and a few days later, he was
almost
done
with
it. But this is Quitting Time.
Here, just put that in front of me.
Yeah.
You don't have to see me anymore.
There you go. But that's...
I'm a prop.
There's a great book by William Serrin, S-E-R-R-I-N, called Homestead. And it's about the decline, the rise and fall of Homestead. And it's an incredible book, but it was so inspiring to me. There was this little old beat-up black-and-white photo of the guys leaving the mill in the book, and I changed it, added it. Obviously, there's color and so on here. But this is called quitting time. I remember what that's like to be, you know, your back's hurting, there's sweat in your eyes, it's burning, you're tired. You know, it's quitting time, and all of a sudden you have some energy, you know, and that kind of thing. So I, as you can see behind us, I'll get this thing.
Yeah.
As you can see on the wall here, I don't know how much of it, but...
Well, they can see some of it like we can right
yeah,
here,
but
the
that,
lower part.
But I, and it just went from there, and I looked up, and it's been a long road. I don't feel any inclination to stop.
No, it's fantastic, the work you do. You get paid for it. You're on commission to do this.
And I paid my house off.
Definitely. And, yeah, we're going to be winding this down. How would you want to close this show out?
You know, well, some of the future... You know what, Al? Could you grab that off the wall? Is that
which?
The,
right here?
No, no. The they were not anonymous.
The faces?
Yeah.
All right.
Just lift that straight up.
All right.
There you go. That's cool. But just to show you
the development events.
Well, this was inspired by... I went to Ellis Island, and they had a lot of photographs of immigrants on the walls all over the place, large ones. And it just... It just reminded me of people I saw growing up in Pittsburgh, even the look of them and so on. And it's called They Were Not Anonymous. I had that moment of clarity where I understood they really weren't the huddled masses. They were individuals with mothers and fathers and brothers. And they really built this country and this area. And this is sort of a tribute. And all my industrial stuff is really like that. I feel it's a tribute to the workers and
it's
families.
It's a legacy that they
built
left.
The area. Exactly. Sure. I went on from there to... lifelong dream. I wanted to take a trip to Italy, and we'll get into some of this.
Oh,
in other
wait to
shows.
Our next show.
But
wait to our next show. What's this book you have?
This is a very great book for anybody that's interested. This was put together by a famous teacher at the Art Students League in New York. It's called The Natural Way to Draw. To me, without a doubt, it's the best.
It's helped you.
Book on drawing. Yeah. If I say the name properly, it's Greek, Kaimon Nicolades.
Okay.
Kaimon Nicolades, but The Natural Way to Draw, it's in like its 40th printing.
Sure.
He was putting this together and he passed away. And his students actually completed it for him. But it's a drawing course for people that can't afford to go to school, can't whether money or time. And
sure.
I discovered this along the way.
After you spent the money and the time.
While I was figuring it out. But this particular book, and I'd like every show I'd like to do a recommendation on an art book, and this would be the number one for folks that and if you're in school, get this and follow what the exercises and things he tells you to do. So
no, that's fantastic. We're going to close the show out. This half hour just went so fast with the information you have. Vince, you're like an encyclopedia that can talk, and you're not digital. I appreciate it. Showing me, you know, your development and telling us more and filling in the blanks, how you're actually a paid professional artist in Pittsburgh. That's amazing. It's an honor to be doing these interviews. I didn't think I'd be with you on the second show. You may see Al Levine, the talking machine, on the third show as we talk about
Italy and all kind of things.
He's now segueing into that, friends. Thanks again for watching our show on BPTV. Be with us for our next show. What show is that?
It is The Creative Process with Vince Ornato.
Exactly. And I just like it because he's saying it about himself. So we'll see you next time.
Okay.